as we continue our conversation about the COVID-19 vaccine rollout in the country, we have with us Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. Senator Sherwin, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to our televiewers. Good morning.
All right. You tweeted the other day, actually yesterday, that it may be time for a change in vaccine strategy in the sense that you said that the government should already allow the general public, so that's already A4++ in NCR, to be vaccinated as early as June. And you say we have enough vaccines to do it. I've asked this also myself, and yet it seems that you do have LGUs and also members of the IATF that are still bent on sticking it with A1 to A3 first, even if there's resistance.
Well, Karen, we're now in the third month of our vaccination program. And from my observation, it's about time to move the general public up in the priority program as early as June. So meaning allowing the general public, anyone who is willing to take their vaccine, to be vaccinated as early as June. And the simple reason for that is by June of this year, we will have 21 million vaccines in inventory. And if you do the simple math, in NCR plus, there are about 26 million in population. And the clincher here is the recent SWS survey where it said that only 32% want to be vaccinated. The vaccine acceptance rate is only 32%. So if you multiply the 25 million by 32%, you get about 8 million. So 8 million is less than the 21 million inventory. So we have more than enough to vaccine the willing people who wants to be vaccinated.
So Senator Gatchalian, what you're saying, kumbaga basta willing, bakunahan na, ganun sa Amerika eh. Yes. Basta willing, bakunahan na, hindi nga tinatanong taga saan ka, anong state ka, anong lungsod ka. Pag parang ganon, kung turista ka.
Karen, I have a small anecdote. And one time I was talking to Senator Sonny Angara, and I mentioned to him about the vaccine hesitancy of senior citizens. And sabi niya, baka hindi marunong mag-text or mag-register. So in Valenzuela, we went house to house.
That's true.
We gave the schedules to all 58,000 senior citizens. And the reply that we get is, ayaw namin magpa-vaccine, gusto namin ayuda. No? And true enough, only 20% of our senior citizens went out to get their vaccine. So to wait for the 80% to go out and get their vaccine, it might take a little time. While the rest of the public want to get their vaccines already. And to achieve herd immunity by end of the year, you have to start with the willing because they're raring to go.
I agree with that. Start with the willing because they're raring to go and ready to go. I want to ask you about the elderly. This is interesting. So do you believe a strategy, local government lang to, that perhaps the local government will already detect which homes have elderlies, hindi pa nabakunahan, dadali na lang ang bakuna doon at may kapalit na incentive. That would mean ayuda, pwedeng bigas, pwedeng kahit ano. Do you believe that's a good change in strategy?
For me, Karen, the most important is to allay the fears. No? If you look at the SWS survey, the number one there is fear that it might cause injury to themselves. Uh-oh. The fear of the unknown is actually the biggest problem. It's not the ayuda. They didn't say that, gusto ko muna kapalit before I get vaccinated. Really fear that is the number one reason. And my simple strategy for that is for the leaders to come out and promote vaccination. The top leaders, no? Our president, our vice president, our senate president, even the speaker of the house, and even media personalities such as yourself, no, to go out and promote. I think, in my humble opinion, people will follow their leaders and people trust their leaders. And if they see their leaders are being vaccinated and promoting vaccination, people will follow. But at this time, the biggest hurdle that we have to overcome is fear of vaccines.
Okay. I want to let you know lang, Senator Sherwin, that your internet is lagging a bit. Okay. So we just have you on audio. We can't put you on Zoom, but just to let you know. Okay. Okay, there. All right. Now, very quickly, there are suggestions in changes in strategies. No? For example, Dr. Tony Liachon said, since it's only Pfizer that's allowed really for the young, and it's only limited, why not give it to students? He said, we have Sinovac, a big inventory of it. Why not give it to policemen and military, since essentially they have to follow the chain of command and they can't say no. And then you specifically set aside Astra for seniors. What do you think of that?
Any suggestion that will improve the rollout is highly welcome. But my initial thoughts is even within the A4, no? For example, teachers, policemen, vaccine hesitancy among themselves is also quite high. So not because we prioritize, let's say, the A4, we still have a high vaccine hesitancy. Only 32% are willing to take their vaccines. So instead of waiting for all of them to be vaccinated, my opinion is to already allow the general public. Because now, if you run the numbers, it's check.
Oh, and if you allow the general public, do you agree with Malacanang's order not to announce what vaccine is being used at that moment in time for inoculation? Because the WHO just came up with a statement that they do support that, because they said it's to be vaccinated that's important.
Personally, my analysis, Karen, to not help overcoming fear.
Okay.
To not aggravate fear among our constituents. One of the things that helps comfort them is knowing what type of vaccine that they will be injected with. Mm-hmm. And a lot of our constituents, believe it or not, they do their research. Huh? When I go around Venezuela, I talk to our senior citizens, they even know about vaccine passports, they even know the efficacy rate, they do their own homework. And by depriving them of the brand in advance might create this notion of uncertainty, and that will not help them in terms of building confidence.
Uh-oh. But then is that the solution to building confidence? I mean, we do know that there's also a preference for Western brands.
That's why my simple solution, and I've seen this in other countries also, is for personalities who people trust, no? Leaders, even media personalities, come out and promote the vaccine.
Okay.
It's not about trust. And we've seen this in some of our researches in Venezuela. They want the mayor and their councillors and the vice mayor to go out and promote the vaccine. And it will help.
Okay.
Not a solution, but I think this is a common sense solution.
How could we do face-to-face classes soon? I mean, what's interesting is even the CHED had already wanted at least college to be face-to-face.
Karen, this is one thing I learned from this virus. It's quite uncertain and very difficult to predict. No? I remember when we had this interview, 400 LGUs were zero COVID at that time.
Yeah.
I think it was like 8-9 months ago. But right now, there are only 78 LGUs that are zero COVID. Meaning 1,400 LGUs have now some form of COVID, some cases of COVID. So in other words, it's quite uncertain. And we are seeing surges around the country. So my analysis here is let this school year end. It will end by this July. Hopefully, August, September, for the new school year, we'll have a better situation. We'll have more people vaccinated. The most important is get our teachers vaccinated. And this is a sign of confidence among in the education sector.
But should there be a reallotment of Pfizer? I mean, I do know that Secretary Galvez, I think, has ordered, 40 million doses, no, of Pfizer. So that will mean 2020. It says here 20 million by June. Is this all Pfizer, Senator?
No, it's different. No, there are some Covax, there's some Sinovac, varying brands.
And I wanted to ask you if you believe that some Pfizer should already be set aside for students.
I am in favor of that. Looking at the trends in the U.S., that they already started vaccinating teenagers, and this is a good sign because, again, no. Parents are very emotional when it comes to face-to-face classes. and allocating vaccines for our teenagers will build that confidence up. Well, as to when, I still believe that we allow first the adults because the adults are susceptible, and when we vaccinate them, they can go back to work. Then after the adults, we can now move into the teenagers to build confidence.
How could the government improve its vaccination rollout policy? If there was one thing it can do to improve it?
One of the things we need to hurdle is vaccine hesitancy.
Yeah.
In the least recent SWS survey, only 32% want to get vaccinated. Mm-hmm. So the rest are still hesitant or unsure. So in other words, we need to overcome that by building trust. And like I said, the most immediate low-hanging fruit is for our trusted leaders and personalities to go out and promote vaccination.
Okay. Now, being the chairman of the Senate Committee on Energy, you are asking the Department of Energy to justify the sale of Malampaya-related companies to the Odena Group, headed by and owned by Dennis Uy, a businessman known to be allied with the president. And do you see something questionable, frankly, with this sale?
Karen, before I answer that, no, let me establish the importance of Malampaya.
Yeah.
It powers about 6 million homes in our country. It powers about 20% of our power requirements. It powers about 35% of Luzon's power requirements. So it's a very important asset. On top of that, it generates 22 billion pesos to our revenues, to our government coffers. So it's no ordinary asset. It's in short, it powers about one in every five homes here in our country. So it's important that we keep our lights on. It's important that we have constant supply of gas. And in order to do that, we need to have very competent and financially strong operators.
Yeah.
And that this is where the question comes in, because in the law, it's very clear that you can do the sale, but government needs to approve that at the end. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is government needs to assure the public that the next operator is competent and financially strong. No? And this is where
DOE... But when you say government, so you're saying you can do the sale, DOE did it. When you say government must approve it, you are referring to the Office of the President?
DOE, in this... In this particular transaction, but DOE is the alter ego of the president.
Okay.
So, in other words, government through DOE needs to evaluate the transaction, making sure that it's legal, it's financial, and technically compliant, and it needs to approve. And the approval, the logic for this is DOE needs to assure the public, all of us, that the next or the new operator is competent and has the capability of running Malampaya and supplying electricity to our homes.
Okay. My first question, was DOE transparent with you? Or I know that you will hold a Senate inquiry, right, regarding this matter, on how much the sale was and the deal behind the sale?
Yes, we will definitely call on the DOE because we had
a first... They have not announced it clearly, right?
In the first hearing that we conducted, actually... their statement is they're still in the process of evaluation. And it was not very clear to us what are the sets of criteria or the criteria that they will use in terms of evaluating this. It has to be very clear to the public what are the criteria. And then number two, if the new company is competent based on those lists.
Yes, but should you announce it first so other companies can actually bid for it, is my question. I mean, to make sure the details are correct, no? So far, the DOE's approved the sale. We're talking about the 45% non-operating stake of Chevron in Malampaya. That's correct.
That's the first transaction. There are two transactions, the Chevron and the Shell's transaction.
Okay. There are two.
Yes, there are two transactions. The first transaction, you can call it as a passive investor, or the investment is passive, meaning it's non-operating. The Shell portion is the operator.
Yeah.
Whoever steps into the Shell will operate that rig, mm-hmm. will supply gas to our homes.
Mm-hmm.
So the second transaction is very critical. because it will now require technical competence, meaning the new operator should have experience at the beginning.
So can the DOC just choose to make a sale without actually going through certain requirements of the company to take over that sale? Like, for example, let's be specific, Shell. Are there requirements under the law that the company must have experience in the past?
Yes. In the law, it's very clear in PD 87 that government needs to approve it. Prior to the closure of the sale, government needs to approve it. And the list of requirements are specified in many of the circulars that were promulgated by the DOE in the past. Mm-hmm. So in other words, DOE has a list of requirements and a list of criteria, and this should be fulfilled before closing, or before government approving and before private sector closes the transaction.
Uh-oh. But then would the Odena Group be qualified based on the requirements?
This is in the hands of DOE now.
Mm.
But the mere fact that personally I made this statement, I have strong doubts. But we will let the process go through. DOE has a set of, processes, and we will allow the DOE to commence with their process, but justify to the public, us being the consumers, we have to be assured that the new owner is highly qualified.
Okay. And under the law, should other companies have been able to bid as well?
This is a private transaction. So Shell can invite other bidders. And from my information, they have. This is the only gas asset in the Philippines. So it's a monopoly, so to speak, in terms of gas. So Shell has, from my information, has invited other bidders. That's their own prerogative. But government's prerogative is to assure the public that whoever steps in is highly qualified.
Or government must prove that they chose the best bidder.
Correct.
For the national interest of the country.
Correct. In short, because like I said, it powers 6 million homes out of the 20 homes in our country.
Do you believe there was preferential treatment for the Odena Group?
I'll reserve my comment for that, Karen. DOE now is in the process of evaluating, and I'll reserve my comments on that. But like I said, I issued a statement because I also have some doubts in my mind that I want to be cleared up, not only as a senator, but also as a consumer of this country.
Okay. We don't have enough time, actually. I wanted to ask you more about tax cuts for work from home employees. Maybe we can do that at another time, Senator, because that takes a longer period. But my closing is, I wanted to ask you about Bayanihan 3. What are you seeing with Bayanihan 3, just generally? I mean, I know you've all agreed to actually extend session time, no, so that you can prioritize on certain measures. And Bayanihan 3 would be one of them.
One of the things that I will be looking at is the spending for 2021 budget and Bayanihan 2, because there are some items in Bayanihan 2 that has not been spent yet. No? For example, a very specific example, the 300 million subsidy for students hasn't been spent yet. And then in 2021, there's a lot of unspent items yet. So my point here is, let's spend 2021 in Bayanihan 2 first before we realign. Bayanihan 3 is in effect realigning 2021 and the other budget. But let's give the existing budget a chance first to be spent.
On that note, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, what a pleasure to speak with you this morning. You take care, sir, and you stay strong. I'll see you again soon.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you for your invitation.